Good morning. Good morning and happy Mother's Day to the mothers in attendance here. This is the day that the Lord has made, so let us rejoice and be glad in it. Let us quiet our hearts for worship. Thank you.
Good morning. Let's stand and worship God. As the Creator and Savior are one, may we all be one. So that the world will see Christ, may we all be one. So that the nations will know that the love of God is for them, may we all be one. As the body of Christ for the sake of the world, may we all be one. The Lord be with you. Lord Jesus Christ, make us one. One in the gathering of the church, one in the teaching of the scriptures, one in the sharing of the Eucharist, one in the sending of the Spirit. Make us one, Lord Jesus Christ, so that the world will believe in you and receive the gift of life you offer. In your holy name we pray. Amen. Bring new life where we are worn and tired. New love where we have turned hard-hearted. Forgiveness where we feel hurt and where we have wounded. And the joy and freedom of your Holy Spirit where we are prisoners of ourselves. Let us confess our sins against God and our neighbor. God of everlasting life, we confess that we continue in the ways of death. You have set us free to serve you, but we serve our own interest. You have delivered us from captivity, but we remain captive to our fear. Forgive us, God of grace. Pour out your loving kindness upon this whole family of believers, so that we may rejoice in our redemption through Jesus Christ, our Lord.
Friends, hear the good news. Who is in a position to condemn? Only Christ. And Christ died for us, Christ rose for us, Christ reigns in power for us, Christ prays for us. Anyone who is in Christ is a new creation. The old life has gone and the new life has begun. Friends, believe the good news. In Jesus Christ, we are forgiven. Since God in Christ has forgiven us, let us also forgive one another. The peace of Christ be with you, and also with you. We welcome all of you to worship here at Westminster this morning. We are so glad that you are with us, especially as we celebrate the sacrament of baptism today on the second Sunday of May. We ask all of you as you worship with us to please take the pad found at the end of each pew next to the center aisle and sign it, and then pass it down the pew, and as it comes back, note the names of those worshiping with you that you may greet them after our service. If you are a visitor with us and think that Westminster might be the place where you can best live out your life as a disciple of Jesus Christ, we ask that you go through the double doors to your left immediately following the service, and there underneath the information sign, a member of this church will answer questions that you may have. In your bulletin, we have the window. We have announcements about life of our church today and in the week and month ahead, and we call those to your attention. If you need to sign up for any of these events, please use the pad in the pew. The Lord be with you, and also with you. Let us pray. Holy God, whose voice is heard in the thunder and in the silence, speak to us now by the power of your Spirit, that we may hear your word for us today. In Jesus' name we ask it. Amen. Our first reading this morning is from the Acts of the Apostles in the 16th chapter, beginning at verse 16. A story of Paul and Silas being imprisoned. Hear the word of God. Our ears are open. One day, as we were going to the place of prayer, we met a slave girl who had a spirit of divination and brought her owners a great deal of money by fortune telling. While she followed Paul and us, she would cry out, "These men are slaves of the Most High God who proclaim to you a way of salvation." She kept doing this for many days, but Paul, very much annoyed, turned and said to the Spirit, "I order you in the name of Jesus Christ to come out of her." And it came out that very hour. But when her owners saw that their hope of making money was gone, they seized Paul and Silas and dragged them into the marketplace before the authorities. When they had brought them before the magistrates, they said, "These men are disturbing our city. They are Jews and advocating customs that are not lawful for us as Romans to adopt or observe." The crowd joined in attacking them, and the magistrates had them stripped of their clothing and ordered them to be beaten with rods. After they had given them a severe flogging, they threw them into prison and ordered the jailer to keep them securely. Following these instructions, he put them in the innermost cell and fastened their feet in the stocks. About midnight, Paul and Silas were praying and singing hymns to God, and the prisoners were listening to them. Suddenly there was an earthquake so violent that the foundations of the prison were shaken, and immediately all the doors were opened and everyone's chains were unfastened. When the jailer woke up and saw that the prison doors wide open, he drew his sword and was about to kill himself since he supposed the prisoners had escaped. But Paul shouted in a loud voice, "Do not harm yourself, for we are all here." The jailer called for lights, and rushing in, he fell down trembling before Paul and Silas. Then he brought them outside and said, "Sirs, what must I do to be saved?" They answered, "Believe on the Lord Jesus, and you will be saved, you and your household." They spoke the word of the Lord to him and to all who were in his house. At the same hour of the night, he took them and washed their wounds. Then he and his entire family were baptized without delay. He brought them up into the house and set food before them. And he and his entire household rejoiced that he had become a believer in God. The word of the Lord. Thanks be to God.
The sermon text for this morning comes from the 17th chapter of John's Gospel, and if you're familiar with the 17th chapter, you'll know it to be a prayer. It is the prayer of Jesus, a prayer that he makes as he readies himself to go to the cross. Our passage today is the ending of that prayer. It is John chapter 17, verses 20 through 26. Hear the word of God. I ask not only on behalf of these, but also on behalf of those who believe in me through their word, that they may all be one. As you, Father, are in me and I am in you, may they also be in us, so that the world may believe that you have sent me. The glory that you have given me, I have given them, so that they may be one as we are one, I in them and you in me, that they may become completely one, so that the world may know that you have sent me and have loved them even as you have loved me. Father, I desire that those also whom you have given me may be with me where I am, to see my glory which you have given me because you loved me before the foundation of the world. Righteous Father, the world does not know you, but I know you, and these know that you have sent me. I made your name known to them, and I will make it known, so that the love with which you have loved me may be in them and I in them. This is the word of the Lord. So do you ever listen in on the prayers of others? A man sits down at a table at Panera. His table pager buzzes and lights up. He gets up and goes to the counter and comes back with a bowl of soup. He positions his glass, the napkin goes upon his lap, and then he bows his head. His lips do not move, But do you hear the prayer? This is the day that the Lord has made. Let us rejoice and be glad in it. Have you listened in on the prayers of others? I know I'm sounding like the NSA here. I don't mean to sound covert. It's not covert. It just happens. I remember right after I moved here, I still had on my calendar an invitation to preach at White Memorial Presbyterian in Raleigh, and so I had to fly back to Raleigh. As I landed in the airport, got my bag, and headed down the escalator, I saw an older gentleman holding a board with my name on it. The older gentleman just happened to be Sophie Maness's father, our director of Christian education. I just met Sophie, and now I'm meeting her father in Raleigh. And we exchanged some pleasantries, and then we started to walk to his car, and he was slow of walk. It took us quite a while. He apologized for it. He said that he had just had heart surgery and was still kind of regaining his strength. When we got in the car, what he made up for in slowness of gait was made up for in speed of travel in the car. Because we buzzed out of the parking lot, down the off-ramp, across four lanes of traffic, and we were heading about 74 miles an hour. All the time, he was telling me about his experience of going under the knife. He said, when I got into the operating room, the surgeon asked me if I would like a prayer, he said. And he nodded. He then said that the surgeon got up and put his heart, the surgeon's heart, on my heart. And he whispered in my ear a prayer. Can you hear the prayer? What's the prayer? I, the Lord God, I am with you. I am with you in heaven. If you go to heaven, I am there. If you make your bed in Sheol, I am there. If you're lying on a hospital gurney getting ready for surgery, I am there. Sophie's father said with his voice cracking, his heart was on my heart. And after he said the prayer, I was at peace. And I looked over and he was crying. A 74-year-old, 8-mile-per-hour gentleman in a car, crying, going 94 miles an hour around a belt line. Did you hear my prayer? Dear Lord, please help me to preach another day. If we listen, I think we can hear a prayer. I know there are prayers being said this morning on this Mother's Day morning for a mother and a father who this week lost their son so tragically. Can you hear that prayer? It's the same prayer that's being spoken by a father whose boy is just getting moved in to go overseas. Where are you going to be stationed, son? I can't tell you, Pops. Top secret. It's the same prayer as the refugee who gathers two of her small girls underneath an evening tarp. It's the same prayer as the farmer in Mozambique who's got good seed. He's got good soil, but he's got no rain. And he's got four hungry mouths to feed. Can you hear the prayer? Prayers, they come from east and west and from north and south, and they cut through the facades of this world. and they cut through the fabrications and they get to the point. And here's the point. Did you hear the prayer? We just listened in on the prayer of Jesus Christ, the Son of God. Now, countless times in Scripture, we know that Jesus prayed. What did we pray? What did he pray? We don't know. Scripture says Jesus took James and John up the mountain to pray. What did he pray? We don't know. Scripture says the disciples found Jesus alone praying. What did he pray? We don't know. But today, we know. And it was some prayer. He prayed it loud enough that the gospel writer could write it down 60 years after it happened. He prayed it loud enough that we could hear it over the centuries. He prayed it loud enough that it would fly across the ocean and up upon the Piedmont and over the Blue Ridge and down the Nashville, into the Nashville Basin, until it trickled into our ears. That's some prayer. It's a whole chapter long, and it is filled with passion and need. It is the deepest desire of God. Holy Father, protect them. These are my people, and they are your people. Protect them in the name that you have given me, so that they may be one and we may be one. Jesus is praying the prayer that we may all be one. Did you hear the prayer? Certainly God heard the prayer. For it is the same prayer that God prayed when he took a handful of dust and he blew into it. And he made all of us. The prayer of God was, I do want to be one with you. I do so want you to be one with me. It is the prayer that God continues to pray, that you are to love the Lord your God with all your heart, with all your mind, with all your strength, with all your soul. And you are to love your neighbor as yourself. Learn to do good. Seek justice. Rescue the oppressed. Defend the orphans. Plead for the widow. Come. Come, let us reason together, saith the Lord. All together now. Let us all be one. God heard the prayer. Is anyone listening to the prayer? We live in a fractured age. Look at our political parties. Not too many years back, they used to talk about bipartisanship. You remember that word? I think they took that out of the dictionary. And then a few years back, it was, let's be a united front against the Republicans. Let's be a united front against the Democrat. Let's be united against them. Ah, the good old days. You remember that? Now the parties are splintering. How do you hold the party line? What's the line? Where's the line? Here's the line. You draw it between me and you. You draw it between us and them. It's just me and you, Lord. It's just you and me. That's the prayer. It's just me and you. Do you hear the prayer? Do you say that prayer? Once upon a time, two men went up to the temple to pray. One said, oh, thank God I am not like those other people, robbers and evildoers and adulterers, or even like that tax collector over there. I fast twice a week. I give a tenth of all I get. It's just you and me, God. We're one. But that tax collector, he looked up to heaven and he beat his breast and he said, God, have mercy on me, I'm a sinner. Did you hear the prayer? Two prayers. Where do you draw the line? Is one in and one out? Or do you listen to the prayer? I mean, really listen to the prayer. For surely if you listen in on the prayer, they all say the same thing. Listen. God, have mercy on me. My life is a mess. I'm trying to put food on my table, and I'm sorry, Lord, but I've had to sell my integrity in order to make sure that my family eats. I look in a mirror and I don't even know who that person is. Heal me, Lord. Love me, Lord. You still love me, Lord. And if you listen in on the other prayer, I mean really listen in. Look, Lord, I fast twice a week. I give a tenth of my income away, Lord, to you. Look, Lord, I'm good, right? I mean, compared to most, I'm giving it my all. You do notice me, don't you, Lord? You do love me, don't you, Lord? I keep wondering if we're dividing ourselves up by the same prayer. We fight because we think love is a limited resource. And someone else is taking the bigger share. The first murder ever recorded in the Bible was over a prayer. It happened after a man named Cain listened in on his brother Abel's prayer. And after listening in, he was convinced that there wasn't enough love to go around in this world. That his brother was taking God's love away from him. And so he rose up with a stone and he killed his brother and buried his bones deeper than a bone. Because he didn't think. He didn't think. He didn't think. He didn't think. He didn't think that God's love was big enough to go around. Look, the gospel writer must have lived in the same time that we do. He just thinks that the world is white and black. He says it differently, that the world is made up of light and darkness. Light and darkness. If it's that simple, if the world is just light and dark, which side are you going to choose? I just know that the world turns dark in a hurry. It'll turn dark in a blink of an eye. Because you see, when Jesus says the amen in his prayer at chapter 17 and chapter 18, Judas doesn't think Jesus has a prayer. It happens that quickly. And if you haven't got a prayer, you start to blame everyone and everything for taking away your life and your love. If you haven't got a prayer, what do? You buckle a bomb around your waist. If you haven't got a prayer, you take a machine gun out and you go on a rampage. If you haven't got a prayer, you forget what your grandmother always told you. If you can't say anything nice about someone, what? Don't say anything at all.
Does anybody in this world remember that prayer of your grandmother? If you can't say anything nice about someone, don't say anything at all. Be careful. Because your grandmother knew that the world can go dark in the blink of an eye. So keep asking yourself the question, does my life look like that cross? Does my life look like hope? Does what I speak sound like resurrection? Because it's a dark world. But in a dark world, light shines. And the darkness does not overcome it. Dear Lord, has the world got a prayer? I remember when I was 6 or 7 years old, I didn't think that there was enough love to go around in my house. I was mad over something. What it was, I do not remember. But there was not enough love to go around. And I told to my mother, I'm running away. She helped me pack, which I thought was a little odd. The backpack all packed up. She said, you got your toothbrush? I said, no. She said, better get your toothbrush. I said, would you like a sandwich? You might get hungry out there. It's getting near lunch. Yeah. And so she put the two pieces of Wonder Bread out and put the peanut butter on both sides. That way the jelly doesn't melt into the bread. You may want to make notes on this sermon as you go along. She said, would you like some apples and cheese? Yeah, my mom used to cut apples in the shape of boats and then take toothpicks and American cheese slices and make cheese sails. I was sitting at the table and she sat down next to me. And she said, you know, I'm going to miss you. When you're gone, and I hugged my mother. And I don't remember ever letting go. Before I go on, is there anyone in this room who doesn't know that they're loved? Is there anyone in this room who doesn't know and might have the courage to raise your hand? Because we really can't go on. Not in this place. The world is too dark. But in this place there is light. And if you raise your hand, if you dare to raise your hand, there are people in this room who will take out some water and a towel around their waist, and they will come to you and they will wash your wounds. They will anoint your head with the tears of their baptism. They will take your hand and they will guide you through the darkest valley. They will show you that the God and Jesus and the Holy Communion of the Spirit, it's right here, it's right now. We're all one. There's enough love to go around. It's a prayer. And all God's people said, Amen.
during the singing of the next hymn, we invite any children who are worshiping with us who would like to be a part of the baptism to please come and sit on the floor at the base of the steps.
Hear the words of our Lord Jesus Christ. All authority in heaven and on earth has been given to me. Go therefore and make disciples of all nations, baptizing them in the name of the Father and the Son and the Holy Spirit, and teaching them to obey everything that I have commanded you. And remember, I am with you always to the end of the age. Obeying the word of our Lord Jesus and confident of his promises, we baptize those whom God has called. In baptism, God claims us and seals us to show that we belong to God. God frees us from sin and death. Unites us to Jesus Christ in his death and resurrection. By water and the Holy Spirit, we are made members of the church, the body of Christ, and joined to Christ's ministry of love, peace, and justice. Let us remember with joy our own baptism as we celebrate this sacrament.
On behalf of the session, I present Luke Christian Dunkerley, the son of Bevel and Mark Dunkerley, Amelia Reed King, the daughter of Margaret Riley King and Casey King, Eleanor Jane Coleman, the daughter of Langern and Drew Coleman, Ella Tate Dick, the daughter of Katie Tompkins Dick and Hagen Dick, and Martha Ashley Boyer, the daughter of Holly Connor and David Boyer, to receive the sacrament of baptism.
I have this question for the parents presenting their children for baptism. Relying on God's grace, do you promise to live the Christian faith and to teach that faith to your child? Do you? And a question for our congregation. Do you, as members of the Church of Jesus Christ, promise to guide and nurture these children by word and deed with love and prayer, encouraging them to know and follow Christ and be faithful members of his church? Do you?
Yeah.
And for our children, this question. Do you promise to love these babies, to be their friend and to teach them about Jesus? If so, please say yes. Through baptism, we enter the covenant God has established. Within this covenant, God gives us new life, guards us from evil, and nurtures us in love. In embracing that covenant, we choose whom we will serve by turning from evil and turning to Jesus Christ. As God embraces you within the covenant, I ask you to reject sin, to profess your faith in Christ Jesus, and to confess the faith of the church, the faith in which we baptize. Trusting in the gracious mercy of God, do you turn from the ways of sin and renounce sin and its power in the world? Do you? Do you turn to Jesus Christ and accept Him as your Lord and Savior, trusting in His grace and love? Do you? Will you be Christ's faithful disciple, obeying His word and showing His love? Will you? With the whole church, let us stand and confess our faith. Do you believe in God the Father Almighty?
I believe in God the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth.
Do you believe in Jesus Christ?
I believe in Jesus Christ, God's only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and buried. He descended to the dead. On the third day He rose again. He ascended into heaven. He is seated at the right hand of the Father, and He will come to judge the living and the dead.
Do you believe in the Holy Spirit?
I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and life everlasting. Amen.
The Lord be with you. Let us give thanks to the Lord our God. Eternal and gracious God, we give you thanks for in countless ways you have revealed yourself in ages past and have blessed us with the signs of your grace. We praise you that through the waters of the sea you led your people Israel out of bondage into freedom, the land of your promise. We praise you for sending Jesus, your Son, who was for us, was baptized in the waters of the Jordan, and was anointed as the Christ by your Holy Spirit. Through the baptism of his death and resurrection, you set us free from the bondage of sin and death and give us cleansing and rebirth. So pour out your Holy Spirit upon us and upon this water, that this font may be the womb of new birth. And may all who now pass through these waters be delivered from death to life, from bondage to freedom, from sin to righteousness. Bind them to the household of faith, guard them from all evil, strengthen them to serve you with joy until the day you make all things new. To you be all praise and honor and glory through Jesus Christ our Savior, who with you and the Holy Spirit lives and reigns forever and ever. Amen. What name is given this child? Luke Christian, child of the covenant, I baptize you in the name of the Father, and the Son, and the Holy Spirit. May the blessings of God, the Father, Son, and Holy Spirit descend upon you and be with you now and evermore. Luke Christian, you are sealed by the Holy Spirit and marked as Christ's own forever and ever. Amen. What name is given this child?
Amelia Reed.
Amelia Reed, child of the covenant, I baptize you in the name of the Father, and the Son, and the Holy Spirit.
and the blessings of Father, Son, and Holy Spirit descend upon you and be with you now and forevermore. May you read, you are sealed by the Holy Spirit and marked as Christ's own forever and ever. Amen.
What is your child's Christian name?
Eleanor James.
Oh, it's okay. So you can get your arm out. Eleanor Jane, child of the covenant, I baptize you in the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. May the blessing of the God of grace and love descend upon you and dwell in your heart forever. Amen. Eleanor Jane, child of the covenant, in baptism you are sealed by the Holy Spirit and marked as Christ's own forever. Amen. What is your child's Christian name?
Ella Tate.
Ella Tate, child of the covenant, I baptize you in the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. May the blessing of the God of love and grace descend upon you and dwell in your heart forever. Amen. Ella Tate, in baptism, you're sealed by the Holy Spirit and marked as Christ's own forever. What is your child's Christian name?
Martha Ashley.
Martha Ashley, child of the covenant, I baptize you in the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. May the blessing of the God of love and grace descend upon you and dwell in your heart forever. Amen. Martha Ashley, in baptism you are sealed by the Holy Spirit and marked as Christ's own forever. Amen.
He's newly baptized into the household of God. With joy and thanksgiving, we welcome you to Christ's Church to share with us in the ministry.
Thank you.
The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Let us give thanks to the Lord our God. It is right to give our thanks and praise. Holy God, we join with your people everywhere in thanking you for all that you are. You are merciful and gracious and keep covenant with us, anointing us with the living water of baptism and feeding us with the true bread and wine, bringing redemption even when we stray from your ways. We will praise you forever, Blessed One, for great and wonderful are your works. Because you have come near to us in Christ, mighty God, we dare to draw near to you with our prayers. We thank you that in Christ we are brought together as one body and sent out to love as you have loved, strengthened and empowered by your Holy Spirit. We thank you that in your gentle mercy and steadfast love, you hear our prayers and enable us to hear a word from you. You are our strong, protective Father and our compassionate and nurturing Mother. We thank you, loving God, for mothers who have nurtured and guided us and whose love for us has shown your great love for all your children. And we pray for those who have not known a mother's great love and care. May we, as Christ's church, demonstrate your tender, compassionate, and unconditional love. O God of grace and mercy, hear our prayers as we pray for those constrained by illness and for those who are hospitalized. Continue, O Lord, to bring to them a sense of your healing presence. Comfort them in your love. We pray for all affected by illness of any kind. Strengthen them and their loved ones who walk with them by your abiding presence. We pray for those who grieve, especially remembering those who are devastated by the loss of a loved one to suicide. We pray for all in emotional distress that they may know our peace. We pray for all who suffer with conflict and abuse in relationships. Give them your peace and the strength to make difficult decisions. We pray for those who are lonely and without family. We pray for those whose lives are diminished by addiction. Help them to know your Spirit's power and to loose all that binds them. And because there is not yet a peace on earth, we pray for those in harm's way. Protect all your children from the devastation of violence and cruel oppression, and help us to be peacemakers. O God, you are the source of healing and restoration and salvation. Show us ways to minister in your name. We are and always will be your grateful people, praying in the name of and with the power of the one who is the living water, Jesus Christ. Amen. In response to God's benevolence poured out for us through the grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, let us return to God our tithes and gifts of appreciation.
Please.
The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Let us give thanks to the Lord our God. We give you thanks, great God, for the hope we have in Jesus, who died but is risen and rules over all. We praise you for his presence with us. Because he lives, we look for eternal life, knowing that nothing past, present, or yet to come can separate us from your great love, made known in Jesus Christ, our Lord. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts, as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen.
Before we'd go out, my mother would say, remember who you are. So remember who you are out there. Remember that you are the light of the world, that we are all together, the one who Christ loves. And there's enough love to go around. Go knowing that the love of our Lord Jesus Christ and the communion of the Holy Spirit are with us all. And all God's people said,
Amen.